tidying using copies. That's one thing. We had a little technical glitch between our copy machine and the computer. So if you're interested in writing an evaluation, it's going to be online. We'll send it that way. And we don't have everybody's bios here, but they're online also. I want to start out today. It's hard to believe I started out in urban stuff in 1974, passage of the Landlord-Tenant Act, and the rise of the Food and Tenant Organization. And it is with profound sadness today that all of us in this room, including me, that the Food and Tenants Organization is no longer. Closed its doors last week. Go to the website, it's vacant. It served thousands and thousands of Greater Cleveland who are low-income people and needed assistance with their rental payments, working with lousy landlords, which there are a few of them out here. And it's sad. Just one of those things that happens. I'm not quite sure why nonprofits live or die, but CTO ran its course, and that's the end of it. So it's very sad. And maybe just take a quiet moment and think about why organizations that serve really low-income people don't survive. So, very sad. Okay, recognitions. Are there people in the room who have been sponsors, i.e. you wrote out a check? Maria wrote out a check. Anybody else? Do we have other people who are sponsors in the room? Well, the county would like to write out a check, I'm sure. We're waiting for that to happen. Anyhow, we want to thank all those people who have been sponsors. I also want to thank and acknowledge those people who participate in our planning group. They're the ones who put together the work that we see at this event. And Molly is part of that, and Sally Martin, and the other people who stand up, Frank Ford, where are the other people who are part of our planning group? Come on, stand up. Round of applause for them. We have survived the Ohio Fair Lending Coalition with a thing called VISTA, which is the complementary group to the Peace Corps. It's the domestic version of it. And amazingly enough, they got money this year from the federal government. I'm surprised, and we got funded. So if you know somebody who is either a young person or an old person or a middle-aged person who'd like to volunteer a year of their life to the work of social justice, you know, call me or email me. Last year we got our VISTA as a result of Sally Martin knowing somebody in South Euclid, and she's going on to Cornell to get her master's degree in public administration. Her term ends as of July 1st. If you know somebody who's interested in this kind of work, social justice work, let me know. The pay is incredibly low for those who just outrageously low. So you need to live with mom and dad or, you know, sneak in with somebody. The other thing is that you do get money if you have, you may have a school bill, so they will compensate you for that. But that's all that we have. We have upcoming, we're going to be doing something in April. This is 50 years. It's hard to believe the fair housing law has been in effect for 50 years. Seems to be some lack of progress on it, but we are going to celebrate it. And thanks to Rita Thompson and Third Federal, we're going to do an event in association with that in the middle of April. We have other events coming up also, planning and working with all of you in this room. And I want a special thanks to CSU, because originally this was planned for the bond group. And there is the ever-popular fire marshal law about how many people you're allowed to have in the room. And we exceeded that very quickly. So that's why we're over here at the Marshall School of Law. We're happy to be here, happy to having in this lovely room, and share your wisdom with all of us. So I'm going to turn it over to Sally Martin, who's going to introduce our panel.
Expanding the work that Western Reserve Land Conservancy has been doing in the city of Cleveland, the city of Lorain, assessing study to basically indicate what those conditions were. And we really wanted that for the inner east suburbs. And so we led a consortium of five suburbs. The foundation generously gave us the funds to do that. So that is the city of South Euclid, the city of Euclid, the city of Maple Heights, Garfield Heights, and Warrensville Heights. So we collaborated on this. We brought in Western Reserve Land Conservancy to do the groundwork with the survey. And then we added a second component by bringing in Dynometrics, a data analytics firm out of Detroit, to take the data that was compiled by Western Reserve Land Conservancy and make it come alive using the power of NeoCanDo to really give us a tool going forward. So not just a look in time, but a template for the future. And that's what we have today. So I do want to introduce the people who are here to speak. We have Isaac Raw from Western Reserve Land Conservancy. We have Frank Ford. And we have our two data gurus. We have Nigel Griswold and Ben Callan from Dynometrics. And so without further ado, I would like to bring up Isaac, and we want to give you a broad overview of this work, because it's been in the headlines quite a bit. And I think the things that are making the headlines are some of the negative sound bites. But the truth is, 98% of the parcels in these five communities were rated good or excellent. And I think that's a positive story. Our values are coming up. There's work to be done, and this survey does provide a template going forward and the tools we need to make data-driven decisions. So thank you, Ryan.
Good afternoon, everyone. Thank you, Sally, for her leadership on this project. Thank you to the Cleveland Foundation for your generous funding. As Sally mentioned, the Western Reserve Land Conservancy has done numerous of these property inventories throughout the state before this five entering suburb project. And to be honest, as many of you know, property inventories are not a new thing. It's been going on from the 70s and before. Some of my mentors have told me the stories of walking around with sheets of paper and pens and Polaroid cameras. But what is new now is that we're able to collect an incredible amount of data, essentially limitless amount of data, relatively easily, as everyone has either a mobile tablet or their mobile phone, and store this data and continually update it. So a little bit of background on our history. In 2013, we started with the city of Lorain, just because they had really no understanding of what the level of distress was in their community and vacancy and abandonment. And not to point them out, but there's a thing called impact bias. And people think that if they see one distressed home on a street, that the entire neighborhood or the entire city has sort of gone by the wayside. And so what this data does is to say, well, yes, while there is distress in these communities, that doesn't mean that the entire community is distressed. And so, while we're more familiar with working in these sort of post-industrial legacy cities that have experienced a lot of population decline, we were really excited to work in these first-ring suburbs where, A, the housing stock and the building stock was a little bit newer in comparison to some of the communities we worked in the past, but B, there's going to be a lot of nuances because, as Sally mentioned, 98% were rated in either excellent or fair condition, and I remember my supervisor, Jim, when he took Sally's initial call, he's like, he had never thought about doing one of these in these inner-ring suburbs because he sort of had his hunch that the building stock was in really good condition. But, there are a lot of nuances with this, some difficulties. One being, it's really easy to determine if a structure is vacant when the roof is falling in and the windows are boarded up sometimes. But it's a little more difficult if there's still window dressings, the lawn is being mowed, and that's really what we sort of came across in all five of these municipalities. So a little bit of the background. We had our initial conversations with Sally and the Cleveland Foundation, and we expanded the list of questions that we asked. And so I'm going to pull up sort of the website that we used. So this is the tool. It's called Loveland Technologies. It's based out of Detroit. And what we really found beneficial to this is that you don't need a degree in GIS or to have a master's in planning to understand and do community mapping. We can really use this as a tool for community development. And the way I proved this is when my mother came to visit, I pulled up her smartphone and we sort of went through on my block in Cleveland and we just said, okay, can you answer these questions? Can you take a photo? And it, you know, my mother is very well-meaning, has a good eye for things, but technology isn't necessary for 4K. And so we found that even, you know, someone that maybe isn't as technologically savvy can easily do this. So if you want to use community members to update this data, that's very easy to do. Now, we hired 10 surveyors, and they tended to be on the younger side. Most of them were college age or referred to us towards employment or the municipalities we worked in. And with Sally Martin's help, as well as the other 4 or 5 communities we worked in, we developed a list of 28 questions. So this wasn't just, is the building occupied or vacant, or what is the letter grade? We looked at, Sally had us look at the materials of the driveway, the lawn and landscaping conditions, if there was a street tree, if the sidewalk was in good shape. So we had 28 questions that then we can use as baseline data with photos to then add and really build off of moving forward. And so when you combine this with the data that's already being housed with NeoCanDo, you get something really powerful that can continue to be updated moving forward. So while I said these 10 surveyors were very young, we ended up having to survey over 56,000 properties in a little over 7 weeks. We started after the 4th of July, so we had some nice weather. Didn't have too many incidences with dogs, only one with the police department, so we do consider that sort of a win. And as Sally said, the majority, 98% of the structures were graded either excellent or good condition. You know, but that's not to say that there aren't challenges in these areas. You know, as we'll sort of see in Frank's and the Dynamo team's research, a lot of this housing stock came online at one time. You know, the median household age was 1956 for most of these communities. I think Warrensville Heights is the newest at 1960. Professor Beyer has done a lot of work in this regard. You know, when you have this cataclysmic aging of housing stock, it will really lead to a lot of interesting dynamics and nuances. So other things that we did determine is that while there doesn't seem to be much as far as distress in the building stock, there are still a great deal of vacant lots in these communities. You know, Euclid and Garfield, I believe, had over 1,200 vacant lots in these communities. That's not to say that all of these lots are developable for infill housing or larger commercial spaces, but they are vacant and could be used for whether it's enhanced green space or side yard expansion or some new infill housing. And so there's a lot of opportunity to do some interesting things. So what I'm going to leave you with before we go to Frank's is that while this is sort of a snapshot in time and everything is time-stamped with the surveyor and what the rating was, this is sort of allows us to do some really interesting analysis on trends. And that's what this data tool that Dynometrics has created does. I like to use the metaphor that, you know, we're still in sort of the first of the year. And so this Loveland tool, which the cities have and can use to update these surveys and these results, is sort of like getting your gym membership, right? You put the money in, you're like, okay, I've got access to this sweet new gym. I know I'm excited, I've got a new Planet Fitness coming in our neighborhood. And then you've got the equipment in there, right? And the different weights and different weightlifting and fitness regimes that you can do, and that's sort of the Dynometrics tool, right? So we've got a lot of these really cool tools, but unless you go in there and put the time and the work and have the policies and the stakeholders in place and to support these, you're really left with just a gym membership that's weighing you down in your back pocket. So before I hand it over to Frank, I'll just show you sort of the general results of what it looks like in the web interface. So I just pulled up the city of Euclid here, so you can see there are 18,015 posts, and there are 18,015 parcels posted to. So that means that we didn't have any duplicate records. We spent a lot of time with the data cleanup and the quality control. And what's really cool with this is that anyone can go in and run a simple query, right? So if we want to say, okay, survey category, we would say, let's say vacant structure and property use, we'll say residential because everyone knows that stable, safe, affordable housing is the bedrock of any community. Load that on the map. We have 591 results. You can zoom in, right? Click on, here we go. Vacant structure, doesn't look like they've got much of a lawn. Let's see if he represents that. Oops. concrete driveway, that looks right, no street tree. One landscaping condition, yeah, I'd say that's pretty poor. You know, so we can do a little bit of fact checking there. And then I can also see that this was surveyor number 6 at 2:43 p.m. on July 20th. And so if you wanted, that timestamp is up here. If I were to go out there and say, okay, let's see if any grass was planted, I could go in and add a second record, and that would then say February 13th, 2018. So these records don't overwrite each other. They're always there as a reference point to see the changes, whether it's in paint color, whether it's in porch condition, and that can be really helpful and beneficial for code enforcement and a lot of the work that Scott Martin and a lot of the staff of these municipalities do. So I can answer any questions about this tool, but again, what's really exciting is taking this data, taking this basic data, putting it in the NeoCanDo system, using it with Nigel Ben's Dynamometrics tools, and then sort of seeing how this all plays out. So without further ado, I'll let Frank talk about his condition research.
In the suburbs, they keep around 08, 09, 10. coming down. They're significantly coming down. In fact, this data is through 2016 here. I just got the 2017 data. It wasn't in time to put it in the report. But that, where you see this has got a downward trend and then sort of leveling off and even going up, that's all starting to come down again. That just was an aberration. Either the leveling or the coming up, it's actually starting to come down. And I've got the data for all of Cuyahoga County, and it shows good news in that regard for the whole county. Sheriff sales, same story. Things are generally coming down. And sheriff sales, the reason that's bad is they put a lot of low-value distressed property out in the market. It's picked up by investors. So that's good news. That's coming down. Vacancy, also coming down in all these communities. Well, in Wardsville Heights, it actually never seemed to get that high. But in the others, the general trend is coming down. And of course, as Isaac already mentioned, going with this vacancy is that the visible blight has come down. And that's really, you know, if you're a prospective buyer looking for a home, you drive through, you don't necessarily always see the vacant house, but if it's really distressed and blighted, that's going to scare you off. And that's been addressed significantly by the five suburbs in conjunction with the county land bank. Median home sale price, this is probably the best news. I mean, obviously you see this tremendous drop, but then notice the trend. It's an upward trend everywhere, and this is through 16. I also just recently got the 17 data, so I'm fairly certain this is going to show a continued upward trend. I'll have that information publicly available probably in about 2 weeks. But that, to me, this is, if I would say, if you're a young couple, looking, everybody's younger than me. So if you're, and you're looking to buy your first home, I don't know where you can do better. These five suburbs have homes that are in decent condition. The prices are actually still affordable, and they're on the way up. I think it's actually something that the five communities could actually market and benefit. Sorry, I went too far. This is not, this is not necessarily good or bad. It's just sort of an explanation of what might have happened here. The impact of all this foreclosure over the last 2 years. Let's just look first, inner ring suburbs generally and west suburbs generally. Go back 10 years ago. Notice the sale prices, median sale, is not that different. There's some difference, but not a huge difference. But then what you get is a difference is the number of foreclosure problems predominantly the African American East Side suburbs compared to the West Side. And then the percent of filings to residential is nearly double. And now look at the impact. Now, can I say for sure that's the only impact? I'm sure it's probably not. But it sort of stares you in the face that here they were very similar. Huge difference in foreclosures and share sales. And then you get this meeting home sale price, and then the recovery, percent of recovery back to 2005 prices. The west inner suburbs are 90% recovery. East are 53%. Now, the good news again, you notice there was that upward trend. So I think we shouldn't, I'm not showing this to say, oh, this is bad news. I'm just trying to show this is probably to explain some of the impact. The individual five suburbs, you can see where they're at. South Euclid is probably the closest coming back to market recovery. Struggling, but again, the upward trend, I think, is the most important thing. So, in terms of the red flags, the warning signs, this is probably one of the biggest ones. That the blue is 2009 tax delinquency. This is residential only, not commercial, not industrial. The red is the residential and 2009. 16. Obviously, there's a big increase there. And that's something that is generally true throughout the county. It's more pronounced in some of the eastern suburbs and slightly in the say, though, that the good news is, you know, some of the people in this room have been part of a group called BAPAC, which raised this issue a couple years ago. It was controversial, but I give a lot of credit to the county, particularly Treasurer Murray, who came in and inherited this problem. And he has worked very diligently with housing advocates and been meeting with us for, I don't know, almost 2 years now. And he's actually made a lot of changes to procedures for how taxes are collected. And although I don't have a slide for it, I did just recently look at the most recent tax delinquency data does show that the delinquency, which is rising, is at least leveling up. It's no longer increasing. The number of parcels that are delinquent is actually coming down, which is good. The other thing is the county prosecutor and the county treasurer just recently announced a joint initiative to address this by creating an effort to do outreach to people who are in delinquency to try to get them on payment plans. I think that's a very proactive approach. This is the homeownership. Again, it's not like a striking huge decline, but it's a downward trend that is impossible. These last figures are the 5-year estimates from the census, so, you know, I don't know, I'm not, there are people in the room who may do more work with census figures than I do, but how reliable is that? I could almost call Lisa Nelson up there to say, how much should we trust that? But when, in fact, Lisa, let me ask you, when is the next census, when is the next stuff going to come out that we're going to be able to see? And is there another estimate coming out?
It will be, I think, in the next year or so.
Okay, well, keep our eyes on that. So I was saying that, you know, you've got properties that are fairly, they're affordable on one hand, and that's good, but it also means that you can have home selling for $20,000, $30,000. And then who's going to buy those? And if the homeowner percentage is coming down, it means investors, they're getting a higher share of that. This last slide that I want to show, this one was somewhat controversial. I had never done this analysis before, and I did it as sort of an experiment to look at the five communities, and I took the 1-3 family arm's length transactions, home sales, and then I looked at the, let me jump to loans originated, and looked at comparing the transfers to how many would have had a loan connected to it. Now let me just jump to a couple things. Let's take the outer suburbs. You've got 6,800 transfers of property sales. You have 5,400 loans originated, mortgages. So 80% of transactions in the outer suburbs have mortgage associated with them. Beside Cleveland on the other end, only 4%. So it's not the transfers that are taking place, 2,600 of them, but there's only 307 mortgages occurring. Now, if you oh, yeah, go ahead. Yeah.
You're saying there's no mortgage associated.
Well,
there are mortgages.
Well, they're not recorded. These are recorded. There are 307 recorded mortgages.
How do you know they're not recorded?
Well, I'm using the Home Mortgage Disclosure Act data.
That is, those are federally regulated institutions.
That's true. Yeah.
So the mortgage brokers and bankers are not
included. Yeah.
But when he goes through FHA, there is a mortgage.
That's a good question. I don't know. And hey, please.
If
a banker in the room.
If a bank does FHA, it is included in their money.
Okay.
If a bank does
it. Yeah. So, I mean, but to Tom's point, I guess what would be the likely percentage and what would be the likely percentage of a mortgage that doesn't get reported, doesn't get captured by Congress? That's the question. And how, you're saying very little?
Yeah, I think very unlikely.
No, Now, there is a way to verify this for sure, and that's how we cross-reference all this county reporter data. And I have to admit that I'm pleased that one of our bankers in the audience suggests that that would be better. And they were asked the question, so we hear that $50,000 loans less banks don't want to make those loans. Because, you know, the amount of work to do the $50,000 loans is the same as the $150,000 loan. Why do we waste the time on $50,000 loans? The first banker, and I'm not going to say who said, yeah, those aren't profitable. The next two, I will say what they are, it's important, said, they're not profitable, we're going to do them anyway. Fifth, third, and had this confirmed with any of you know Henry Studemeyer, who's been a realtor in Cleveland and his father for decades. He said something very interesting to me recently. He said, the truth is, the word is out amongst my colleagues that anything below 50,000 just assume it's going to be a cash transaction. In a way, so why are there low applications? Is it partly because people don't, they're not going to apply? They know they're going to get turned down. The realtors. Now, Henry did say, he said, I'm very pleased that Fifth Third in particular has a product. To me, the big question here is, are these communities moving towards being investor-owned communities versus homeowner communities? If there are transactions taking place, there are homes available. Our record research shows they're decent homes. They may be just a $45,000 sale. Is that inherently a bad risk? I don't think it is. If the home actually appraises for 45, the borrower can pay the money. We're not talking about the risks from 10 or 15 years ago, when banks were making loans to people who couldn't pay, the information was falsified. The appraisal was said it was falsified, said it was really worth 90 when it wasn't. I'm talking about homes that maybe it's a real $50,000 home that does appraise, the borrower could pay it back, but does the bank say, you know, we don't want to be bought? That's the issue here. And I can't say that opportunity for home buyers to get decent homes. Anyway, I'm actually done. There's no grand flourish. There's no like wind up here. Well. Within your county, but you did the five cities here.
we take every parcel comprehensively and then we look at all the details over time and how all the dynamics of every parcel changes. And so doing that research, we've done some different policy work that's affected how the U.S. Treasury releases funds for demolition activity. I know there's been some of that that's occurred in Cuyahoga and across a lot of different states in the Midwest. Effectively, that research it helps understand the impact on that, of the activities, the interventions that land banks and other housing authorities are doing within their local units. And so that's how we originally got engaged in the discussion with Sally, is Sally's really curious about how have all these rehabilitations that we've done in our community impacted the property values nearby? How have the demolitions that we've done in our community impact the properties that are nearby? And so the way that we set up data systems allow us to measure those things. And so the way that we think in like, so you hear big data, the way that we think about it is there's like two data sets. There's the people data set where you have, you know, social security number or some identifier to a person, and then it's all the people, and then there's information and there's time series that explain that person. What's their credit score ultimately, or what's the different details about their spending patterns, or all the advertising stuff, right? So that's like a data set. That's a big data set. There's a lot of information there. That's not us. What we do is the land side. So we use unique identifier parcel ID. So every single property in the whole U.S. has boundaries to it and has an ID, like a unique ID, that you can catalog. And then there's what's going on in that property in every single time period. And so what's happening in every single time period, once we have that all integrated into a single location, think tax delinquency, how much is owed on tax delinquency, if that property sold, how much did it sell for, all those details, physical attributes, number of rooms, bedrooms, bathrooms, etc. So now once we have all that in every time period, then we also know the details of every property around it. So now you can start to get ratios at different distances, like micro neighborhood. You can cast out 500 feet, you can cast out a quarter mile, and get ratios of what's happening in the micro environment. And as you go over time, that micro environment is going to change dynamically. And so if you're investing resources in demolition or rehabilitation, you can actually build models to point at how those activities impacted and shocked that micro environment. And that's what spatial econometrics is in a nutshell. And so you have demolitions, rehabilitations, infill housing, vacant lot improvements, economic development projects. Name a list of all the activities of what you can do in a micro level environment to try to change those dynamics, potentially protect property value, lower crime, whatever the public sector program is. You can actually start to get into whether it's working or not working through these data sets. So we're scientists, so we have to control the micro environment. So the way that the data system is set up, it deals with different levels of control in the microenvironment. So unpacking that, you have to be control freaks about the microenvironment every time period. So the first one, it's kind of chunky. You say, okay, so neighborhood types are going to vary. So we have all the census data at the census tract level or the block group level, where you can, you know, we take 30, 40 variables and we say, how are those, like, how often are those the same and how often do those, how do those chunk up into clusters? And so in Cleveland, we generally found four primary clusters of neighborhood typologies. We found stressed rental markets, we found special rental markets, which are like high-end rental, whether it's, it tends to be folks that are older without kids that are in a higher rental market, or they're like folks that are between 20 and 30 that make a decent income and are willing, don't want to buy, pay high rent. So there's some of those areas. And then you have primarily ownership areas that that are functioning medium, and then you have like higher functioning ownership areas. And that's what we found primarily in Cuyahoga. But you chunk those out, so that controls for like macroeconomic differences. You have like think about houses that are apples to apples, but in one neighborhood they're worth 40,000, and in one neighborhood they're worth 190,000. depends on the school district, it depends on all these different factors. And so you have different sub-markets. So that's a big chunk, that's a control factor, so that we can actually understand what's happening at the micro scale from change. That's the goal, right? So micro neighborhoods vary. So even at the micro scale, like that individual property you're looking at, that environment around that, you're looking at more occupancy rate. So that darker green at the parcel level is a heat map of the micro environment. So the density of owners varies where that house is. If you move up in this direction, then you're looking at more rentals, higher rental rate. If you're moving in this direction, you're looking at higher ownership rate. And so that micro environment, whether it's tax delinquency rate, or mortgage foreclosure rate, or how many vacant lots are there, how much blight is there, all those details vary at the micro scale. And so we can count all that and know those densities for every single property. So you control that micro environment by getting those ratios of what's there in every house. And then the individual properties vary, so you're gonna have different kinds of bedroom, bathroom, square feet, you know, is it brick, is it wood, all those details, we control for all those details as well. And then time varies. What I have here is basically the yellow ones are unoccupied residential, so that's like a vacant house in this time period. So it's 4:30 of 2010. This is Jackson, Michigan, it's just an example. But like, that's how much vacancy in this neighborhood that you're looking at right here at that time period. The thing is, those will fill in. You actually have a time slider, so you can see those properties get occupied by rental or become owner occupied. Every single time period is a different story for every property, right? And so we're controlling for time because we're seeing the change over time. And then I say home value impact of neighbors and interventions vary. So what we're looking at here is after we actually run the model. So the way to model the numbers, you take the sale price of all the numbers that actually will buy or will sell or sold, you take all those controls, and you understand how each of those components impacts the value of the house. So you know if the vacant lot impacts the house, what's the percent? So you can actually say, oh, a vacant residential lot in the stressed rental area, that's across the roof of my house, it's a negative 0.29% impact on my property from that vacant lot across the roof. If I have a land-made one residential structure, which is like a proxy for light in my home property, that's a negative 9.8% impact on my property value when I'm in the fancy rental zones. With the moderately function ownership area, 5.74, and the high function ownership area, almost 11%. Now the way that modeling works, and we actually quantify the impact of demolition and rehab, is that you say, I have a negative 11% property across the road from my house. That probably just turned into a no impact. It's just a vacant lot in a high ownership area. So that swing, that swing is felt by all the neighbors. So you can actually, and we know the value of the neighbor's homes. So we can actually say, that value, the way that you got to that value is because the negative 11% is removed. So that's proxy modeling. So because we know the value of how every neighborhood, every type of environment works, you can then quantify that. So that's how we do rehab. So if you go to an owner-occupied tech or owner-occupied tax current, you know the effect of the owner across the road from any house and all the kind of the greater premium is involved. We know that value impact if you have a neighbor nearby. Now there's intuition here. I mean, if you're in a high functioning ownership area, of course you're going to have, like, everybody's an owner, so it's a small positive impact. But if you're in a stress rental area, an owner nearby is a big deal. So you're going to see like 0.46%. So there's a lot of intuition. This is a proxy environment. So if you have that man-made home residential structure that's having a negative 9.8%, and you swing it and you get an owner in there, and you rehab, you can actually quantify, okay, how much did the rehab cost? How much did all the property guys nearby get impacted? And does that actually cover the spread of the cost of the rehab? So you can start to play with it now. So that's the outcome. So in this study specifically, we applied this finding from a previous study. We did a proof of neighborhood progress on the impact of rehabs. And we applied it to all the
quantification of how much demo impact was there, how much rehab impact was there. And there's an interface where they get to explore all that, see all the other data sets, and kind of contextualize the survey. So they can say, oh, here's the current status of properties, here's the trends and changes occurring on every single property, and here's the impact of my intervention activity, all quickly accessible. So that's the idea, is that they have a decision support tool to actually know what's happening, and we're available to work with them to help make it useful to them. So that's our contribution. And so that's what we do, how we do it. That's my job. So Ben is gonna he's gonna go into the tool now, and he gets to show you guys how the tool works. So thank you.
I'm going to take you through Neighborhood Intel. This is the tool. This is the tool we built. As Randall said, we spent years doing analysis, understanding property dynamics, and what we found is that if we're able to show the impact, show what's happening with properties, then it can help in communication of the results. And there's a lot of data that we've been building into systems that can be useful in the decision-making process otherwise. So we built Neighborhood Intel over the past year. We've built it in multiple communities in Ohio and Michigan and elsewhere. And what we did in this project is we built a tool for each city. So there's an internal tool with a wealth of information, and there are public tools that are available to show results of the analysis that we perform, as well as a lot of the data that we're drilling the analysis. As I mentioned, the data that drove the analysis, that came from NeoCanDo. What's been exciting for us in working about here is that NeoCanDo is available for us to be able to do the research we need to do. And if we build and do research in other communities that we've done in Detroit, Indiana, or Jackson, Michigan, we have to build that NeoCanDo data set ourselves before we can do that research. And then we build it into the Neighborhood Intel system. Neighborhood Intel lets you sync data across departments, whether that's public data that's available within the assessor, treasurer, or elsewhere. And then we're also able to integrate other information. As we do in this project, we integrated the information from the survey. So the idea is having data in one place can really help help in the decision-making process. And then it can help in sharing the results with the public as well. So let me take you a little bit through the tool here. So this is Neighborhood Intel. On the left side here, we've got these little stacked layers. This is how you get to all the different layers that are in the system. And then we're looking, what I'm going to do is I'm going to show you one city right now. We've actually got five tools, but I want to show you one city. We're looking at the actual analysis results in South Newport. So I've got two layers up right now. There's the demolition impact layer and the rehab impact layer. The demolitions are the triangles, the rehabs are the blue dots. And then the darker, either of those ones are the larger the impact that we estimated in our modeling process. As a user, you're able to go to this tool, go ahead and log in, and explore the results. So I'm going to go ahead and click on a demolition here. When we click here, we get this. There's a 500-foot buffer around every property. In that zone is where the impact occurs. It's on the modeling process we get. So So there are a number of houses that fall into that zone. We're able to see that this is the address of the property. The estimated impact on these nearby homes that fall into that zone is $765,000. Total of 124 homes were impacted. So this is a high impact sort of area. You can see the submarket. I was talking about those submarkets. This is a higher functioning ownership area. You get the average sale prices. And then you get to see when the demolition occurred. Additionally, I'll talk a little bit more about survey results in the context of this, but you're able to get all the survey results on that property. Also the picture that came from the survey. But then all of the things that we control in that micro neighborhood in the modeling process, all those things that are happening on that property are available as well. So you can see the current average sale prices, how sale prices are changing around that property, occupancy, owner occupancy, mortgage foreclosure, tax foreclosure, tax delinquency. These are all those things that, as Nigel said, we control for, but now they're also available in the interface, so if you want to know what's happening around this specific property, you can actually see what's been happening and changing in that neighborhood. Additionally, we've got some trends mapped out over the years of residential occupancy and tax delinquency. Again, as Nigel mentioned, having this information about every single property and every different time periods is how we're actually able to do the analysis that we do. So let me take you through a few other layers here. We actually had a demolition. This is a good example. We had a demolition that turned into a new build. So we got the demolition impact there. And then there's some rehabilitations as well. So rehabs, I'm going to show you a rehab just real quick. This was an NSP, neighborhood stabilization program. Rehabilitation happened in 2013. Same sort of thing. We applied the impact that we had found within our modeling process before to the different rehabs. So that, again, the total impact here is $592,000 that it distributes across 82 properties that fall under this impact zone. Additionally, on the tool, you're actually able to download the layers here in either a table format that can fit in Excel, shape files for mapping, or KMLs for putting into Google Earth, and then when that's downloaded, this gives you all the specific information on where you're looking at. And just as an example, we've given some totals in the report of impact and demolition in South Euclid, and we're actually able to go ahead and sum the impact. And it's the same total that we found in the report. So access to a lot of information within the tool here. Additionally, all of these heat maps, those things that drove the research, you're actually able to see concentrations in the city of sale prices. So this is that we have a method where we go up 500 feet, we see what's happening in that area. We're able to map that story of in the city, so you can see concentrations of value. Concentrations of, say, owner occupancy. There are just interesting dynamics to be explored here, too. We've got some lower owner occupancy areas here. When I start mapping things, frankly, something a little bit about owner and renter occupancy, we've got larger tax delinquency concentrations in renter occupied areas here. So, all part of the same story. Same thing with mortgage foreclosure. Then, important for us to be able to understand change, we've got heat maps of change in the city, right? So where's occupancy going up? Where's it going down? Same thing with tax delinquency. How are things changing through time? There's access to a lot of different layers here. And then for reference, you know, most of the time when you look at these sort of systems, you get census information. information. We also build census information into the systems we build. We do build the full census in, but this is a sampling that we thought was interesting to this product. We put through to the front end. But you've got median home values. So this is usually the lowest, most detailed sort of information that you can get out there, and a lot of systems available. What's interesting to look at here is you can actually see, I'll just bring it up, average sale prices. Median household income lays over pretty well with the concentration of average sale prices, but you lose some of that detailed view that you get at the property level. Then, one of the key parts of the system here, again, the reason we're able to map and understand change. I'm going to close my analysis layer real quick. We know the occupancy status of the property. So we built the data system through the end of July in 2017. The dark green places are owner-occupied, light green is renter-occupied, unoccupied residential, the yellow homes, and then commercial industrial are blue here. We've got this time slider down right here. I can actually move back in time, say to 2013, and the map will update, and you're actually able to see the occupancy status of those properties at that time. And then you can actually hit play and watch as the neighborhood changes over time. An important contrast here. So survey results, these are the survey results, right? A lot of A's, especially in some people here. This is all about building out a story about what's happening to properties and what's happening in neighborhoods. We can actually look at tax status. Overlaid with the survey results here. And you can see that while the survey might indicate one thing about what's happening in the neighborhood or happening at the property, we actually also know the tax status, how much those homes are selling for, the occupancy status, and how those things changed over the prior years. We also put in a few different context layers here. So they've done a few different programs related to the ban recipients, commercial property interventions, and the home inspections. So, and then the last feature I wanted to show you here, similar to that one tool that Isaac showed, we can filter by results of the survey as well as some of the statuses that we found. So for example, I can find those places that are tax delinquent, that have a grade of, let's say, B or C. And then I can actually select how I want that layer to come up. Whether I want it to look like the survey layer or the tax status layer. I'll just go ahead and pick the survey layer here. I hit submit. I get that list of properties that pop up on the screen here. And also download the same thing. And get information on those properties. Same sort of thing with even say the street trees here. So one of those places, one street tree. Same sort of thing. You can filter the information, get access to the data that you need. And again, we've built a foundation not only just for the visualization of this information through the platform, but for, we usually call this analytics revenue. So if there's another question related to changes in neighborhood, or why occupancy is changing in a place, or how or crime dynamics, those sorts of things, we've actually built a system that you can respond to. Or data quickly in the neighborhoods and properties. So let's see.
answer in, so the people in the back can hear. I'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Race can be explicitly used as a variable. It's so highly correlated with so many other components that we don't use it directly. The way that it'll be used, I'm not sure if we use it in two-stage multivariate cluster. Okay, so in the neighborhood variation, we stress rental markets, like the special rental zones, moderately functioning owner and high functioning owner. So racial composition at the census tract level was included in that process. So it's a clustering process. So basically you got a principal components where you say, okay, we have these 30 variables, break them up into different groupings of, like, minimize the variance on each cluster, right? So you have like really alike groups, and then you maximize the difference from the next group across the variables. So there's like that process. And so that's how we control for race, I guess. It's at a neighborhood scale, right? And then you k-means it, then you break it in the right numbers of clusters where you get the most natural break. And so that's how race is integrated into this research process.
You all could define how you define value. So as opposed to according to a ratio right now, it has a text ratio, right? Versus what your model is showing.
Sure. So our model is pure observational market value. So it's all based on all the arms, willing buyer, willing seller, arms length sales. So all in statistical significance. So pure regression analysis based on arms length sales. So if you have, we have something like 45 or 46,000 arms length sales since the beginning of 9 through end of 16, I think that's about right, for greater Cleveland, right? And so each one of those sales, then let's say it's $110,000, and then you have all these variables that unpack the micro and
environment at the time period that it's sold. So we know how each neighbor impacted that $110,000 sale at that moment, as well as the neighborhood type it's in, as well as the number of bedrooms, bathrooms, et cetera, et cetera, et cetera. And then run that over all those controls over 45,000 times, we get the exact understanding of the percent impact for an incremental change in each detail, right? Each of the variables. And so that's how it's quantified. It's based on the market fit.
Sorry, which one is that? So, yeah.
It's not in there right now, but it's easily integratable. If it's in that format, if it's a shapefile, you can integrate it. That's the short of it. And I think that's important because what we haven't talked about is use, right? So the individual, like actually putting the work for practitioners in the five cities, I think is something we haven't totally talked about, right? Like Isaac talks about some, like the, you know, there's the survey. Now it's like, now there's changes occurring, so you got to resurvey and have that in a piece, right? But how are the five cities using it in action, I think is critical. That gets right to that.
I think how we're using it in action, for instance, you know, I know I've had an erosion of home ownership in one micro neighborhood more than I've had in another. That might be an area where I want to target down payment assistance, or I want to create a program to increase home ownership in that area. So the mapping tool is very robust and dynamic tool for us to drill down the micro neighborhood change. And you know, anecdotally, just in the city, we know in some areas we're just not seeing recovery the way we are in other areas, but this really allows us to quantify that and then target programs to address it.
Information that can explain the difference between maple heights
So it would load into that neighborhood typology difference. So that's where all the macroeconomic and all the cultural components, all the different components of like how neighborhood fabric is pieced together, those chunkier variables, like the neighborhood typology variables, are where all that loads in. So parsing through that and knowing those details, this isn't controlling for that. You're doing that in like a hacksaw kind of stuff away. I guess it's the short answer. Like that's not postdoc. We're taking all of that stuff and loading it into a chunky variable. Because we want to isolate the goal of the research we've done anyway is to isolate the marginal effect of individual neighbors and not understand that this city and that city, why? Right? Like this is their trend, this is their trend, why? That was the question. And so the way that that was the research question, the way that we parse through that is probably more in the thread of thanks. Aims to understand those differential potential trends and then trying to parse it out. What causality is why, right? But that's not what this does. We just chunk it all in and say, different type of zone, and then go into the neighborhood.
So, you have a question?
You've shown there's a tremendous amount of data here on the zone of the modeling subway. I wonder whether or not considerable when there isn't there some set of templates that would be, if we're talking about people being able to use generally. So things that I think the community is very interested in is what is the impact of demolition? What is the impact of loan origination or loan denial? What's the impact of code enforcement? So that there would be some specific products that somebody could just come on and decide to say, okay, here's your general landscape of some of the things. And I was wondering also about how the data, whether that's something that you have integrated or could be, because that gets into some of the question about races too, what we see in terms of some of those things. So are there templates that for us who would be overwhelmed with this abuse or is that
what we've been working so hard to understand. So, I mean, we've got a standard way that we bring in data. Like Nigel mentioned, we can integrate any data that's spatial, or it's HUMDA data, or schools data. We brought in code enforcement data, other cities when it's available, same schools information. This is the first time we've presented as much information as we present in school, so it's sort of an experiment out there. So. We're looking for feedback. In the past, we focused solely on the intervention. So there was a demolition, there was a rehabilitation, what was the impact of those activities, and what would the potential impact of future activities be in different locations. So, I mean, the template of it is sort of driven by those who we're working with and the questions that come. When we're actively working in the cities, we work to be responsive and clear in terms of the information that we're putting out there. So, that's a long way to say that the template just depends on how I use it.
So, for this project then for these five cities, then it suggests you had some specific research questions. What were the things that you were looking at and what are your conclusions?
The conclusions that were laid out during the previous rehab study for neighborhood progress effectively, it was a benefits transfer. So those conclusions are that table you saw where the differing impacts of different types of neighbors near you, right? And what the swing is, if you have a different type of neighbor near you, change one property across the road into a different type of property across the road, you know how it impacts your property value. Those are the conclusions. And so application of those findings is the rehab and the demo, right? So we know the blighted structure turns into the vacant lot. That swing, each
property nearby is affected by that. That's the conclusion, so we can quantify that. And the rehab, switching it from a blighted structure or homes for closed, unoccupied structure into a renter or owner-occupied tax current structure, we know how that changes value nearby because of the findings of the model. So those are, I mean, those are the interpretations of the findings, so I would call that conclusions, right? But, and so we just applied that again to this. We said, where are all your rehabs? Where are all your memos? We'll quantify that, right? So it's an extrapolation, effectively, from the previous study into current activities in each of the five cities. And the thought on the template side, it's effectively like assessors, treasurers, and vacancy information is our standard piece. So, and then add-ons to this. So maybe it's like, oh, what's this, what are the details of each individual property, veteran, bathrooms, et cetera, that we can get out of the assessment data? And then treasurer's data, like what's the tax situation? And then vacancy, it's like, you know, is it occupied or vacant? And we can then deduce renters and owners out of that to set up. But that's like the base. And then, you know, code enforcement data or permanent data, like all that can get integrated. But that's where it gets custom a little bit, depending on who we're working at, what the questions are. So it's kind of a, it's a vessel. So it's a vehicle to that. So it varies by practitioner what the standard is and some of the trends.
And real fast, I would like to say that there is an overall report that synthesizes their results, Frank's results, and sort of our action items looking at this data that can be found on the Western Dirt Lake Conservancy's website under our property survey tab.
Yeah, we have time for maybe one or two more questions. I know Khalil has his hand up.
Yeah, this is a really quick one. I'm just curious, it just occurred to me that things like owner-occupied versus rental, rental occupancy permits, that sort of thing, can be not reliable. That data can be really unreliable sometimes, and so I'm just wondering how you handle that kind of thing. I mean, vacancy was a survey, I get that, but things like whether or not something is a rental, it may or may not be classified. So
there's two methods being used. Where available?
But what I would say is that you have a clear So which way to go? Sometimes maybe the cheapest thing to do is to demolish that property and have a vacant lot there. But guess what? Now there's no revenue stream. Revenue stream over into the long term isn't as high on that individual property. Even if you sell, even if you get it to it as a side lot. Maybe it was rewired. It opens up the option value for infill, right? And you can get a new house built there, and now you have a better tax revenue stream. But now you got to manage that lot until either demand increases and it doesn't get snapped right up, or what? So you've got to understand the demand for housing in that specific neighborhood before you make a choice. And knowing, so you can actually know holding costs. If you look at the maintenance budget, you go, that house is in great shape, but nobody has been vacant, not to have to close, and it's going to fall into disrepair. We estimate this is what our maintenance cost is for the next 6 months of the year, which is what the land bank does all the time. You have to come and say, okay, that's a good escrow potential property, let's give it a shot. And you think, do those holding costs not fall in the call? And if the market has an incentive to act on its own, they knock it down because they're incurring too much cost. So that, there's so much trade-off. So the individual names of the best you can do is understand the opportunity cost of your choice, I guess, is sure. And so
I would like to add just, we are, there's three or four white men that don't live in these suburban communities, so we've been really fortunate to work with the staff and the mayors, and I would say the biggest thing is it's not about individual mayors, it is about the impact that they're having working together on this. And the biggest thing, right, is that the median housing costs are around $50,000, and people, A, aren't able to get traditional lending, and their payments then aren't going into escrow to pay their taxes, which is leading to possibly higher tax delinquencies. And if you can even get into this house, how are you going to pay to rehab it? You know, so the perfect example was a call-in to the Idea Stream, where it was a young person who wanted to buy a house in South Euclid, but realized that it was 65 years old and needed a lot of rehab. And so if there aren't programs like the Heritage Home Loan Program, like the health program through the county, that people know are available and can access, and don't have to worry about the appraisal coming back at $100,000, when really they might only be able to sell it for 60. I mean, these are the sort of the tough things that we as a region need to say, we're acting together, we're pooling our resources, we're gonna subsidize or at least incentivize redevelopment in our urban core or in our inner ring suburbs, and not keep subsidizing and incentivizing greenfield development on the fringes, which we've been doing for a very long time.